Tuesday, join Hercule Poirot for Triangle at Rhodes on Mystery.
This is KLRN Channel 9 in San Antonio.
The Frugal Gourmet is brought to you by the members of KLRN and your neighborhood HEB. Proudly supporting the Frugal Gourmet and serving San Antonio with convenient locations for your culinary needs.
By a grant from LK Manufacturing Company. LK, dedicated to satisfying America's taste for fine kitchen products. LK offers the full line of sinks, faucets, and accessories, including gourmet stainless steel sinks with a lasting beauty finish. Just say LK, the state of the art in the cooking arts.
Additional funding provided by this and other public television stations.
How are you? Welcome again. More on those three ancient cuisines which most influenced the West. China, Greece, and Rome. Today we're going to talk about sauces. I know that when you think about sauces, you generally think of France. There's a good reason for that. The French use sauces as an integral part of their cooking. A great saucier in France is a first-class cook. He's not a secondary cook. Everything is integrated with the sauce. The sauce makes the dish. But in the ancient cultures, the ancient kinship, China, Greece, and Rome, sauces are secondary. That is to say, in China, it is illegal to cover over the flavor of one dish with the flavor of something else. And it's always been that way. The Greeks think the same way, and the same with the Italians. We'll argue about that, you and I together, as we go on today, but we want to talk about sauces. For instance, pasta sauce in Italy is nothing like pasta sauce we use in America. Americans always put too much pasta sauce on, just a little bit. Marcella Hazan says that sauces are very minor in Italian cooking, except for what we call sugos, which are the pasta sauces. Most of them are tomato, you know. Those are the ones you know best. But we always put too much on. They use just a little tad. And in Greece, there aren't any complicated sauces, with the exception of perhaps abgolemono. And you know who invented white sauce? Bechamel sauce? It has a French name. It was invented in Greece 3,000 years ago. That's the truth. I wouldn't tell you otherwise. So sauces play a very different one. And in China, they're just fascinating. So let's begin right now with a Greek tomato sauce. It's very easy to prepare. I have my pan hot. Remember, hot pan, cold oil, foods won't stick. That's a Chinese rule. I have in my sauce, in a frying pan, some onions and a bit of olive oil. Let me give you some amount here because you're going to want this one. All right, cool down. 3 tablespoons of olive oil, 1 yellow onion, a clove of garlic that I've chopped up, and I've sauteed that for a bit. Just a bit, you see? That's ready now for the tomatoes. And the tomatoes are easily prepared. Have you ever seen one of these gadgets? This is called a tomato shark. Isn't this scream? And you can core a tomato. Look at that. Just like that. Any good gourmet shop will have one of those for you, or any good department store, you see? Tomato shark, it's called. It's really kind of a kick. We'll chop up the tomato. I want about 4.5 cups of tomatoes, or, something like 5 tomatoes. Now, if your knife is sharp, you're not going to have a lot of mess on the board, you see? Well, Smith, you should have sharpened your knife a little bit more, but not bad. These are very ripe tomatoes. I always buy my tomatoes ahead of time and then I have to sit around. If you're going to go to the market the same day that you're cooking with tomatoes and expect to get something that's usable, you're out of luck. You are very mistaken. All right, about 4.5 cups of tomatoes. That should do it. Now, there we go. Let me add a few more ingredients for a basic Greek tomato sauce. And this is basic to Greek cooking, though it is never used to cover over, but always to add to. I want a couple tablespoons of parsley. Just throw that in. There we go. That'll do it. And I want about 2 teaspoons of oregano. That's very Greek. One of my friends who watched constantly sent me some oregano that you bought in Greece, and it was so good that when I was in Greece recently, I bought some more, and Greek oregano is simply wonderful. And then we want to add a little bit of allspice, just a pinch. just a pinch of allspice, and we'll add some red wine. I want about a cup of good red wine. Remember, it's got to be drinkable, or you shouldn't have it in your kitchen. There's a cup. We'll let all of this cook down. Cinnamon and allspice threw you, didn't it? But that's very, very Greek. Very, very Greek. What have I left out? I think we're all right. Parsley, oregano, dry white wine, cinnamon, allspice. And if your tomatoes are not terribly ripe, add some tomato sauce. I generally do, just for kicks. This is a little 8-ounce can of tomato sauce. Cook that down now. You'll need some salt and pepper in order to correct it. The whole cooking time will be about, 45 minutes or so. Let me show you what you come up with, because it's very delicious. And it's certainly easy to make. There we go. The result in about 45 minutes will look like this. You see? See how beautiful that is? See, the colors have mellowed, and of course the flavors have mellowed. Now what would you do with it? Well, it's great for cooking with meats. You can cook lamb in this. It's absolutely wonderful. Or you can cook a common vegetable style in Greece is to cook vegetables in a little tomato sauce and olive oil. See how oily this is and rich? I have about big package of frozen okra. Yes, they do use frozen okra in Greece because the Greeks love okra all year round. I put about a fourth of a cup of olive oil and about a cup of my Greek tomato sauce to come up with okra cooked Greek style. You can do this with meat. You can do it with anything. They just use this all the time. It's wonderful. But it's not a cover. Not a cover. All right, let me heat up a bit of lamb broth for you. I want to make a... here it is. I want to make a... Avgolemono. Now, avgolemono, or egg lemon sauce, is not at all complicated, and it's very, very interesting, because we know it's a very old, old sauce, and it uses the glorious lemon. When did the lemon come to Greece? Well, I don't know, but we know that it was in common use at least 1,000 years ago. So, you know, we're talking important things here. Now, first of all, let me remind you that a roux consists of flour and butter cooked together. Or you can use olive oil if you like. Here's my roux. I've already prepared 2 tablespoons. Well, I'm going to need a rubber spatula to get that out, aren't I? Here we are. 2 tablespoons of flour and 2 tablespoons of butter. And this is a roux. You see, it isn't colored yet because we want the sauce to be light. And I'm going to stir that now into 1 cup of lamb or chicken broth. This is already boiling. Just a minute. I just lost my... Boy, this is crazy here. Too many gadgets. You've got to have good cooking equipment. There's no such thing as cheap cooking gear. I see people buy expensive cars, and they have terrible kitchens. I can't understand what they're saying to themselves. They love to ride around, but they don't like to eat? Doesn't make sense. Now, we'll thicken our 1 cup of broth with the roux. 2 tablespoons. There, you see it's thick right now. We'll let that cook for just a minute here while I prepare the rest of the dish, and it's very, very simple. It consists of, let's see, what'll we use here? This'll be fine. It consists of the juice of 1 lemon. I'm just about finished here. You know, I always just put my strainer over a measuring cup. It's so easy. There we go. And then ream it out. The juice of 1 lemon, 2 eggs, which I'm going to whip up in a little jar here. Whoops. Oh, look at that. Look at that. Boy, that doesn't happen every day on television, does it? I certainly wasn't expecting 2 yolks. You see that? Well, it'll certainly help the sauce because the yellowness of this sauce is not from lemon juice, of course. It's from wonderful egg yolk. So whip up the eggs. Add the lemon juice from 1 lemon. Pour it right into your eggs. Just put it right in there. No, it's not going to curdle. It's all right. It'll curdle with heat, but it won't curdle this way. And 2 tablespoons of water. 1, 2. All right. Now, you see the sauce is boiling on the stove? You see that? I want to move it off the burner. Move it off the burner. There. Now we'll stir in our egg and lemon mixture with a little bit of water in it so that we... And do this in... There. Okay. There we go. Now, cook this. Back in the burner we go now. Here we go. Stirring all the time. Yes, yes, yes. And let this simmer for a minute. What would you serve this on? Let me taste it first. I think it needs some salt and pepper. Oh, that's good. Oh, that's good. That tastes like the back streets of Athens. or the back streets of Delphi, or Mykonos, or Hydra. I had such a good time preparing for this series for you. The fact that I can make a living having this much fun is really kind of embarrassing. I really enjoy myself. A little salt and pepper, and we'll have the sauce. Now, let me show you what you put this on. One of the great dishes, of course, in Greece, is lamb. And you can put this sauce on vegetables, of course. It's wonderful on asparagus. Gives it that lemony flavor on artichokes. But it's terrific with lamb. So I'm going to put out a big roast of lamb here. Where did I put my big roast of lamb? What did we do with our roast of lamb, Greg? Do you know? Well, here he is. He's right in front of me. How come I can't see these things? There we are. And I need a ladle. And we'll just ladle on a little sauce. We don't want to ever cover over the flavor of lamb. It's too rich and wonderful. If you don't like lamb, please calm down and stop groaning in your chair. Remember that those of us who really enjoy eating have learned to barely cook lamb. You just threaten it a bit. Lamb should be pink and nice. See how thick the sauce is? Isn't that gorgeous? Now, was that complicated? Of course it wasn't. Put avgolemono on lamb. Oh, that is just a superb dish. Really wonderful. That's a sacred dish in Greece. It really is. All right, let's go on to an Italian-style sauce. And this one, I cannot take the time to make an Italian tomato sauce for you. Besides, I've done it before. So what I'm going to do instead is to show you what it looks like. There you are. It's simply nice and thick. I've made it with beef stock, tomato puree, tomatoes, garlic, herbs and spices, and some sautéed vegetables. Onions, celery, carrots, that sort of thing. Cooked it down. There's no meat in it. Now, I want to show you something that is in the style of the city called Bologna, from which we got bologna. Or really, it's mortadella. But that's all right. I'm going to heat some brown gravy. This is the sauce bolognese. Heat some brown gravy and put in about the same amount of good Italian tomato sauce that I've made myself. Mix that up. See, so all of a sudden, you have a very rich, rich mixture. And into that, I'm going to put a bit of meat it's just an old pot roast. How old? I don't know how old. The pot roast, however, was cooked for a long time so that I could shred it. I simply boiled it in a bit of white wine, water, just barely, not even covered, you see, white wine, water, and a bit of salt and pepper. That's all there is to it. And this becomes the meat that you can use to throw together a very quick pasta dish. Pasta bolognese. Bolognese. So when that's heating, I'm going to get the other two ingredients that we're going to want. We don't need any salt and pepper because the meat had salt and pepper on it. And the sauce is certainly spiced properly. So the other thing we want to add to our sauce bolognese is a bit of whipping cream. You're right. You didn't turn in on low calorie today. I'm putting in 1/4 of a cup, something that would tickle. You stir that a bit as it heats. We better get the pasta in the pot, huh? That'll just take a minute. Oh, and some cheese, of course. We've got to have some cheese. Right into the sauce. Because there is no cheese in this sauce. There. Now, look, I have enough here to serve... Oh, I bet I've got enough here to serve 6 people. You see, you don't use... you don't use sauces on pasta in Italy like we do in this country. There's just no reason to. So we'll get some pasta in the pot. I pre-cooked it. What a sneaky trick. But I have no other choice when we're cooking together. So I'm just going to heat it up. I pre-cooked it a bit till it was just barely al dente, just barely to the tooth. Al dente, not Dante. Dante wrote poetry. Dentist is your man you go for your teeth, remember? He's your friend. All right. I need to remove that. It just takes a minute to heat up. Kind of fun. Look, I found in Chinatown the other day. Down at a shop here in Chicago, a shop called Woks and Things. And these are from Hong Kong, and they're used... Look how functional this is in your kitchen. Isn't that a kick? I'm going to put this in my colander. If we want to drain it properly, and I want to get all of this out of the pot, you can't leave a few in there because the next time you cook a batch, why, of course, there'll be 4 or 5 hangers-on. And they're just as soggy as can be. Nobody likes soggy pasta, except you kids who eat canned spaghetti. Oh, am I embarrassed by you, but when you do that, shame on you. Learn to boil water and cook up the spaghetti and It's wonderful fun to make spaghetti. Wonderful fun. There. Now, we'll just let that boil. You see, our sauce is ready now. Let me drain the water from our pan. There we go. The sauce is ready. It's hot. So we're going to put a bit of meat sauce on our dish. Sauce bolognese. Bolognese. I had this... Oh, what was the name of that place? In the city of Bologna one night, and I suddenly realized what they were doing. This is so close to what they were serving that I have to say this is it. And it's just delicious. It's very rich. It isn't all that dark red pasta that we see in American Italian restaurants. You know what I mean, the neighborhood mom-and-pop place? I love those spots. But what I'm trying to say is that's much more... This, what I'm doing now, is much more typical of Italian saucing than is what goes on in our country, because Americans really insist on having a lot of sauce on their pasta. I don't know how we got started on that, but you just don't find it in Italy. There. Isn't that gorgeous? It really is flavorful and just wonderful. Let's garnish that with a bit of parsley here. Here we go. A couple pieces, huh? Just a little bit to add some color. That'll do us. There we are. And out it goes. Wonderful fun. You see how easy that is? It's a beautiful dish. Now, what's next? So many things. Another Italian sauce that's very, very strange because it's easily understood if I tell you it's a bunch of garlic, olive oil, and chopped parsley along with some condiments. That you understand. But when do you see how it's used? Food processor. I'm going to put into my food processor 3 cups of parsley. Now, I don't want a lot of stems, so I pull the leaves off of this. Gee, I hope I get everything in there. I think we'll make it. All right, a little bit of parsley. I want 1 small yellow onion. I've chopped up too much. Chop these things up so that we don't... Why am I chopping these things before I put them in the food processor? Well, because I don't want this thing to turn to mush. And if you have to chop everything up in the processor, you're going to get a big pile of mush, and we don't want that. I want 3 cloves of garlic. I'm just going to crush them ahead of time so that I don't have to run the processor so long. You understand what I'm saying? 1, 2, look, I have 4 in my hand. You saw me, didn't you? Well, that's the way it goes, because when I call for 3 cloves, you know I'm going to lie and use 4 myself. This is for boiled meat dish, also from Bologna. A wonderful, wonderful place for food. Oh, I ate well there. And a stalk or two of celery. Oh, a couple stalks. This should be enough. There we are. And then I want to add, let's see. Oh, this is interesting. The bolognese use giardiniera. This is pickled vegetables, you see. Cauliflower, carrots, celery, pickle, and vinegar. And I want about a half a cup of giardiniera. You buy that in a jar at the market. And a 1/4 cup of capers. Don't buy cheap capers. If your life is worth anything, it's worth good capers, I promise you. There. 1/4 cup of good capers. Are you ready for this one? 3. Count them. 1, 2, 3. Anchovies. And some dry pepper flakes. About 1/4 teaspoon. Red dry pepper. You know what this is. Buy them in any market, you see. Put that in. And now 1 1/2 cups of olive oil. And we'll just let this whole thing grind. Isn't the kick? It really is delicious. When we had this in Bologna, I was just shocked. And then we had it again in Caesarina, in a wonderful place in Rome. Now, I need some white wine vinegar. I want about 3 tablespoons of white wine vinegar. 1, 2, 3. Kind of scoop it up. Isn't this a strange sauce? What did I forget? That's it. Salt and pepper. Let me give the recipe again. Parsley, yellow onion, garlic, celery, giardiniera, capers, anchovies, dry red pepper flakes. A bit of olive oil, white wine vinegar. We're going to finish it off with some salt and pepper and a little bit of color, namely the greetings of a lemon, just the peel of a lemon, not the white part, just the zest of the lemon from about 1/2 lemon. I'll need some salt and pepper now, which is always on the other side of my kitchen. And then we'll grind that up. Now, in the meantime, Craig, will you bring me that pot of bolita? I've boiled a whole bunch of meats for you. And this is typical of Bologna. Just set it right there on the edge. Thank you, friend. They put in a big pot of boiling water, along with a little bit of celery, perhaps, and some carrots and some parsley. They put a great amount of chicken and tongue and sausages and pork and beef and just on pig's feet, all kinds of wonderful things, so that you can really prepare a fabulous... fabulous meal, all from one pot. That's the original boiled dinner, you know, that we know in New England. Grind all of this up. There we are. Not too much now. I want kind of a... Well... we've got it. I want kind of a mess, but I don't want a soup. These are technical terms. If you don't understand me, why... we'll put that on a platter and... here we go. Here's a big serving platter for us. Now, I would put the sauce right in the center of the dish so that people can dip a little bit out and put it on their meat. Let me dish up some of the meats. I boiled a whole bunch of them for you. They're really very delicious. Well, if I can even get them over here. That's a heavy, heavy pot. We put an awful lot of stuff in here. There it is. There it is. Look at that. Isn't that fun? Let's see what we have, huh? Let's see what we have. Well, we have a half chicken. All right. Let's put him out. All boiled meats. And they're all boiled together. Put him on the platter here. And let's see. I see some sausages. Well, that'll be great. We don't want the vegetables. Ouch. You are too hot there, fella. Calm down. And we have, here's a pork roast. Tied pork roast. That's wonderful. And they slice all of this up. You see, it's all eaten with this green sauce. Just terrific stuff. What else do I have? Here's a beef roast. Just a bit of pot roast that I trimmed carefully and boiled. Put that on the plate. And we have, I'm looking for some pig's feet to upset some of you. Here they are. Boiled pig's feet are not to be frowned upon. They're wonderful, wonderful eating. The Italians have always loved them. I have one more sausage. There. This is a big plate of bolita, or boiled stuff. Literally, I think that's what the name means. Just boiled meats. And in Italy, it's so much fun because they'll bring a cart to your table. And the cart is a big tank. And in the tank, they have all of these boiling meats. And they just take them out one piece at a time and slice them up for you. It's a wonderful dinner. There we are. Oh, boy. There. How's that for boiled meats? Isn't that fun? Now, let's do some Chinese sauces, because we don't want to forget the best cooks in the world. I think the easiest thing to do is to tell you that the difference between dip sauces and what we call a normal sauce on a dish is the fact that the person at the table is able to finish his dinner himself. The dip sauces are put in front of him, and then he finishes the dish by choosing various sauces. I'll show you how easy they are to make. For instance, one of the sauces that you're going to have on your table, and this one you just buy in a jar, is fiery hot garlic and red chili paste. That's wonderful stuff. My friend John Young used to eat that like, oh, I couldn't believe the man. Now, here's the second one. So easy to do. You want ginger and soy sauce. And this is, ginger has been cut into little julienne sticks, you see? Little matchstick, fresh ginger. Cover that with good light soy sauce, not that muddy stuff, good light soy, and we'll use that for one of the sauces. Let me choose a spot here, huh? Now, we can add to that. We'll put just a few sticks in here. This is great for dipping meats and dumplings. Or if we add to that a bit of rice wine vinegar, then we're going to have a different sauce. All right, same one. We're going to put them around the table. And, of course, the fun is trying to figure out which is which, isn't it? But normally I would serve sauces that were a different color in this thing instead of what I'm doing today, but it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. I haven't time to put all the other little dishes out. Oops, one more I want to cook for you, too. One more really interesting sauce. You can also do this with sesame oil. Add a little sesame oil to the dish, and you have a completely different sauce. Now, let me show you one more thing. While my oil heats, I want to talk with you. We're going to have a way of thinking about the difference between Westerners using sauces, because they always try and cover things. We're always fighting creation. That's why we use oil paint, you know, because we can go back and keep fighting the paint until we get what we want. In the East, you don't do that. You try and flow with things. Taoism means that you're in the flow of things. So here is your art lesson for today. Here is a painting of a man by Rembrandt. And you see it's always from the waist up. Now contrast that, please, with this Chinese landscape. No, it's a painting about a man. But in the flow of things, finally at the bottom we see him, and he is in his place. He is in tune with things. So you see, he would never use sauces. You understand my point? He would never use sauces to cover over something. He would only use sauces to help things, support things. make them more flavorful. Here's a wonderful sauce that we picked up at a restaurant in Hawaii. I've got to check my pronunciation because it's terrible. I can't find my note. Here it is. It's very important because my Chinese friend is here today. I don't want to blow this. Lu Fao San Fishing Village outside of Hong Kong. If you can get up there sometime, oh boy, will you have fun. I have peppers, hot peppers chopped up. A little bit of, this time I'm using dark soy sauce instead of light, dark soy sauce. And look what he does to this. You can do the same thing with green onions too. But the crowning touch here is to pour hot peanut oil. My oil isn't quite hot enough, but we're going to do it anyhow because that's what we're doing today. That's the time we have. Pour hot peanut oil in on this. There we are. And it cooks the peppers a bit, makes them absolutely delicious, and blends all of the flavors. Now, this is used. You can put some garlic in here. You can do all sorts of things. But this would be used on a dish of blanched shrimp. There. Blanched shrimp from a restaurant called Oiman. I'll give you the recipe in a book. I'm not going to run out on you, but I wanted you to see the sauces. Oiman in the village outside of Hong Kong. There. Okay, the point today is really quite simple. At least I think it's simple. What I want to say to you is that sauces are very different in the three ancient cultures over against classic French cooking as we know it now. They're not as heavy. They're not used for covering. They're used primarily for support. So today, what I've done for you is to prepare some Chinese condiments. Sauces? Sure, they're the same thing in China. We made a Greek tomato sauce and cooked some okra in it. I made an avgolemono, one of the classic sauces, probably the ancestor of mayonnaise, on lamb, boiled meat with green sauce, and a quick sauce